Welcome back for the second half of this interesting late afternoon. It's about read-write landscape. And now is the author of this famous book, Urban Literacy, Reading and Writing Architecture. It's Klaske Havik, and here is written a lot of her biography, and in this brochure you find even more. So it's quite interesting. She studied architecture and also literature. She combines both in the field of architecture, and she mentioned in this afternoon that she's kind of an exotic there in the institute in Delft, because she's working in between the fields, and that's generally the most interesting, to listen to such let's say more colorful people. And and what's really interesting, she's not only in the theory with literacy, she's also a poet, and her poems are in several Dutch anthologies, and maybe you also have an own one, you can tell us about it. And she's teaching not only in Delft, where she is associate professor, she's teaching places like Skopje in Macedonia, Tallinn in Estonia, and there was some more. Tampere, Finland, Helsinki sometimes. So she knows Europe by heart. And I stop now introducing her. If I missed major things, you may add it yourself. Please welcome Klaske Havik here on stage. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert, for your introduction. I hope I can be as colorful as you have promised me to be. And thank you, Zas, for inviting me here. It is a real pleasure to be here in Ljubljana, especially in Ljubljana, because it has been an important place for me and for my work. Let me see. Yes. I will speak to you today about two books and a little bit more. Urban Literacy, Reading and Writing Architecture, which explains my literary approach, if you will, to architecture, urbanism, landscape, and why literature would be relevant for us as architects to think about. And another thing is how this can be used in landscape is our recent issue of the journal OASO, of which I'm one of the editors. This was published last autumn, issue number 98, Narrating Urban Landscapes. Urban literacy is indeed about the place that architecture and literature can form together. And for this book, it's not at all about any specific architectural work, but there's one architectural or urban or landscape work, it's between scales, I guess, that is prominent in the book, even though it's not the topic of the book, and that is the Tromostovje, the three bridges of Plečnik. And if you see these three lines on the cover of the book, you see it was recently translated in Spanish, and the graphic designer decided actually to use the real image that was behind these three lines in the book. I used the triple bridge as a metaphor for the structure of my work, of the bridging architecture literature and the three different perspectives that somehow overlap, that form together one space of architecture and literature, but with slightly different perspectives. And in this short lecture, what I will try to do is to use this triple bridge in different ways. There will be three parts of the lecture. One part explaining this reading and writing architecture, explaining this triple bridge. One part about the OASE issue, narrating urban landscapes. And I will close with a story I wrote about Plečnik. And that is more a fictional story. have to check the time otherwise. So that I know that I'm not keeping you too long from the wine. Okay, why should we look at literature? If we're interested in architecture, in design, in landscapes, in cities, why literature is relevant? I took the detour of literature to investigate three themes that I found very important in architecture, in my own experience of architecture, and that I found missing in my own education and in the discourse. And these three themes were the experience of architecture. How do we perceive places and spaces? How do we experience them? How do we remember places? Why do they make a certain impression upon us? So the experience, the lived experience, if you will, of place. Second, the use. The role of the user in architecture. A building is never finished when the design is done and when the contractor is ready with the work. Then it starts. That's when the life of a building actually starts, by its users, by changing uses, by differences in use, in time, and in a way the user is the co-producer of the meaning of this space. As Professor Gantar was saying, the people as well make the place. It's the society that makes place. It's not only the designer that makes it. The third term that I wanted to address was imagination. Of course, by definition, we imagine new places. We design something that's not yet there, so we imagine based on a certain reality. I think it was really beautiful how Georges Descombes said, imagination is not fantasy. It is an intensification intensification or an extrapolation of reality. It's a way of reading, understanding reality and imagining from there. So these three themes I found somehow missing or only poorly addressed in architecture theory or in the knowledge ahead of architecture. And I wanted to find a way to address them. If we look at these themes, there are certain seeming paradoxes underlying them. If we speak of experience, we speak of the relationship between subject and object. Our perception is a subjective experience of objects, of a spatial reality. But at the same time, when we speak about experience, if we enter the realm of phenomenological philosophy, it's also about the interrelationship and the reciprocity between subject and object. If we speak about use, we speak about the relationship between the designer and the user. In case of architecture, when we speak of literature, it's about an interactivity between the author and the reader, as the reader, by your own memories, your own imagination, co-produce the book. There are descriptions, but if there's a description of a house on a mountain, you have your own image of that house on the mountain. It's not only the writer who decides how the story unfolds and what images arise. And if we speak of imagination, we speak of the balance or the field of tension between reality and fiction. So these three fields of tensions are somehow difficult for architects to address, because we're trained, at least I was trained, in a kind of functionalist tradition where everything had to be argued and objectified. So speaking of the relationship between subject and object, or between reality and fiction, it's not something that you can grasp so easily and explain so easily. So these are somehow difficult to deal with, or these paradoxes are often avoided. While in literature, writers they're by definition dealing with subject and object, with they're writing for a reader and they're taking the reader along their stories and give them a role in what they know and what they don't know and how they read the story. And of course they play with reality and fiction. So realizing that these three notions that I was interested in, experience, use, and imagination, had to do with certain paradoxes that are very close to what literary writers are dealing with, I came to these three, and here is my triple bridge, these three scriptive notions. description, transcription, and prescription as three, not necessarily parallel paths, but three paths that would bridge architecture and literature, and that would provide us with different approaches, overlapping approaches, that can help us to understand the experience, use, and imagination of space. And I will briefly go into these notions. First, description. So we spoke about experience, about subject and object relationships. And I will tell you something about how I studied evocative descriptions in literature, descriptions of architectural spaces. And I'll give you a brief account of some main theoretical notions lying behind that, related to phenomenology and the poetics of space, and say something about how certain architects have used these descriptive, as I call them, tools. In literature, well, of course, a famous book, or series of books, actually, seven books of Marcel Proust, A la recherche du temps perdu, In Search for Lost Times, is the English translation. I think it's translated under two different titles. In any case, this is an image of the Dutch translation. In Marcel Proust's work, the way that architecture is experienced and how it's experienced over time through a character that's aging, that's growing and starting to develop a different attitude towards the places and spaces that he visits and grew up with, is an example of literary descriptions of architectural spaces where the sensory perception and the way that the places are remembered is very, very present. Italo Calvino, I think most of you know this book, sorry, I have the Dutch title here, Invisible Cities, is I think a book that many architecture students have come across at some point, a description of 52 kind of fairy tale cities, very short stories, which each of them can be seen as a kind of extrapolation and exaggeration of a certain urban phenomena. So there's a city of science, there's a city of the dead, there's a city of social networks, there's a city of plumbing, there's many cities that are described in a fairy tale kind of way, very, very exaggerated, but at the same time constitutes all these different layers that the contemporary city is about. And here is a Dutch reference that I want to give you that's maybe not so known internationally. One of the great Dutch writers, Harry Mulisch, he passed away some years ago, The Discovery of Heaven. Fantastic novel where architectural spaces are described very meticulously, but of course they play also a role as not only the setting of the novel, but also they have a kind of symbolic role. Of course, you recognize here on the cover the Pantheon, which is one of the spaces that's very present in this novel. But there's different spaces in the Netherlands, in Jerusalem, in Rome, in Cuba, different places in the world that are described throughout this novel. And a last reference, speaking about how literary writers are able to describe sensory perceptions of space. As architects, we're often limited to the visual. We learn architect, and I'm showing you images as well, which is, of course, a bit stupid. We're raised to look, to see architecture by means of images, and we're also taught to produce images. While, of course, we experience space not only with our eyes, but with all our senses. In this book, The Silent Girl, I think is the English name, of Peter Hoek, Danish author. There is one episode where there's a kind of detective story, and there is one of the protagonists is holding a phone and hears from the conversation on the other end of the line where the other speaker is located in the city. Because this person has such a strong auditive capacity that he has an auditive mind map of Copenhagen. He knows, I hear church bells somewhere in the distance, there's traffic, there's water, it must be that street or the corner of that and that street. And if you realize that the way that you experience the places where you live and that you encounter in your everyday life, you're never really aware of all these other senses of the sounds of these spaces. But once you start to think about it or once you start to describe that, you realize that these other sensory perceptions we tend to neglect, but they're very, very present in our experience and also remembrance of places. So if we want to learn about the way that people relate to places, maybe we should have a look at literature. Of course, I'm not the first one to say this. The human geographer Yifu Tuan in Topophilia, a book from the 1970s, The Love for Places, he said, and this is a quote, "The forceful and precise articulation of environmental attitudes requires high verbal skills. Literature, rather than social science, provides us with detailed and finely shaded information on how individuals perceive their worlds." So indeed, he says, maybe it's in literature that we find much more information about these perceptions, these experiences of space. If we look at the way that literary writers are able to communicate a certain quality of space, we could also, of course, look at poets. And Gaston Bachelard in The Poetics of Space, La Poétique d'Espace, wrote about these ways that poets describe, in his case, mainly the intimate places of the domestic. How certain spaces are described by poets and how poets are able to recognize some small details, some materialities, some shadows in space that seem very simple and meaningless, but that somehow transpire something more universal. Bachelard said many things. "At the level of the poetic image, the duality of subject and object is iridescent, shimmering, unceasingly active in its inversions." So when the subject and object come together in different ways. We are perceiving subjects, but at the same time we're objects. I'm perceiving you and you're perceiving me as an object. And so there's always a relationship between the object and the perceiving subject. And it is even more so in poetry, in our perception of spaces. The Dutch poet Rutger Kopland, who wrote many poems about the Dutch landscape, was also a psychiatrist. He was a scientist. And in one of his essays, when he was asked to compare the work of the scientist and the work of the poet, he said, "This is what the scientist and the poet share, this ability to have an aesthetic experience when the I disappears for a moment in favor of the it." So if a scientist makes discovery by suddenly linking to different theories or formulas, it's a moment of discovery where you suddenly realize, well, I am bringing these things together, but they have a larger meaning than just me experiencing them. It's the same with a poet who recognizes a certain experience and is able to translate that into a poem when that experience is not anymore only about the individual experience, but it's something that can be communicated and understood by others. An architect who used this knowledge, these ideas of phenomenology, of perceiving architecture through the senses, is, among many others, Stephen Hall. This is a sketch of the Kiasma Museum of Contemporary Art in Helsinki, where I think he did a very clever reading of that urban landscape, of the lake above here, the Töölö Lake that's coming into the city, the different directions of the grid, and the building, an intertwining, a chiasma, in the words of Merleau-Ponty, of the great philosopher of phenomenology, where he made a building as a crossing of two different directions. And at the same time, in phenomenological philosophy, this crossing of the subject and object and of these different dimensions is also very present. And here you see in his work that even if it's only an image, so I can only present to you the visual, but maybe you can see through the indirect light, the shadows, the way that the walls and ceilings are plastered, the way that the floor is very shiny, the way that the lines between the floor and the walls are very sharp, that these spaces are really designed for the experience, how you walk through, how you see the light reflecting. You can almost touch these walls even if you see only this image. So he's very much aware of architecture as something that's experienced by the senses. Okay, I'll speed up a little bit. The second part of the bridge, transcription. Transcription, as you remember, was about use and about this relationship between the designer and the user. In my book, this is about social space in literature. Professor Gantar spoke about use as something very often used in a very limited way. I speak about use as something, the social aspects of space and how we need to understand that people live in this space and use it in different ways. How in literature, how can we learn through literature about the social dimension of space? You could say that sometimes literature is also providing us information about these social conditions, about society. Here are two books by James Joyce that both in different ways deal with transcription, as I understand it. Dubliners is a book in which he describes the city of Dublin through the eyes of, I think it's six or maybe more, different characters who are from different social-economical backgrounds. So they also use the city differently. Of course, this was early 20th century. And there were big social-economic differences in Dublin at the time. So you would have people traveling with a carriage, and there were people walking, and there were people who were able to visit the theater, and people who were not. So each of these protagonists, each of these characters in the story, they have a whole different story about the city because of their social position. So that's a novel, one of many, of course, that tells us something about how society functions and what is the relationship between social practices and space. The other book on this slide, Ulysses, by James Joyce, is maybe about this interaction between, it's also about one day in Dublin, but here the role of the reader is really becomes important, because in the way that this book is structured and in the way that many different literary forms are used, the reader is kind of challenged to take part in this book, because it's you almost have to decipher these different parts of the book. So this is where he really challenges the reader to become part and the reader to become a co-producer of the experience of reading the book. And another book that was maybe inspired in some ways by James Joyce is this thriller of Mark Danielewski, The House of Leaves, where the house becomes the protagonist. And there are many different layers of the narrative. I'm not going to go into too much detail because I think we have to keep an eye on the time. And another author that challenges these ideas of how we conceive of spaces is Georges Perec, Species of Spaces, Espèces d'Espace. So the social dimension of space, if you want to learn about how people use the city and how are their everyday practices, in the words of Lefebvre, this lived experience of space, what is the social space about? It's not only something that we can measure, but it's also something that's lived and that's stored in the stories and memories and myths of people. Maybe we should turn to literature. Here's Michel de Certeau, The Practice of Everyday Life, who asked whether we should recognize the theoretical value of the novel. Of course, novels are often fiction, but he says there is so much knowledge about everyday practices, about the everyday lives and trajectories of people in the city, that we might need to look much more seriously at literature as a source to understand society. He says, I didn't read the entire quote, he says, a theory of narration, so a theory of telling stories, if you will, is indissociable from a theory of practices, from the way that the city is practiced, as its condition as well as its production. So, if we want to understand these everyday practices of the city, they are part of the stories of the city. So it's the condition of these everyday practices that they are narrated. But at the same time, the way that we use and experience the city is also informed sometimes by these stories. So its condition as well as its production. Someone who worked, an architect who worked a lot with this idea of narrative, of the way that the story unfolds and events take place in space and time, is Bernard Tschumi. And this theoretical project, the Manhattan Transcripts of the late 1970s, is a project where he spoke about Manhattan in a narrative way, telling a story of something that could have happened in Manhattan through space and time. And what he tried to do in these Manhattan transcripts is to relate spaces, movements, and events, saying that architecture is not so interesting as such. It only becomes interesting when it's used and when it's confronted with different activities. So what he did in this theoretical project was to confront the urban grid of Manhattan with all kinds of movements and all kinds of users. So there are, I think here you see football players, but there were soldiers and dancers and all kinds of movements and all kinds of activities sorry, that somehow entered the space and thereby changed the way that this space was perceived. So you see there's this distortion in the grid. This was, of course, 1970s, time of experimenting with representation, with deconstructivism. But you see here in the middle line that he's using notational systems of choreography, for instance, to think how different figures would move through space and how that would influence their perceptions of space. And this knowledge of, or these methods, you could say, of the narration and of confronting spaces with unexpected events was something that he used as well for the competition entry of Parc de la Villette in Paris just 2-3 years after he finished the Manhattan transcripts. As you probably know, the Parc de la Villette was built up of three independent layers: the layer of the plains, the layer of the points of the folies, and the layer of the paths. And by designing these three layers independently of each other, you would have unexpected encounters. And that was exactly his idea, that a park shouldn't be programmed. It shouldn't impose on people which way to walk and what to do, and here you have a playground and there you have to do that. No, it should be something that invites for many different things to happen. We move to prescription, the third part of the bridge. Prescription, not so much as the prescription that you get at as a recipe at the medical recipe, but prescription, if we look at Latin, prescribere, to write before. So we write for an unknown future. We imagine new situations. In literature, of course, it's by definition imagining situations. But there are different ways in which writers deal with this relationship between reality and imagination. And sometimes these imaginations are critiques or speculations. So if we look at George Orwell, 1984, which was written in 1948, this was, of course, a doom scenario of an English city in a far future, 1984, where control would be one of the main issues. This was, of course, an imagination, maybe a fantasy, but actually this was an extrapolation, an exaggeration of something, some tendencies that he saw in reality, like the growing control and so on. So His fiction is a response, a certain critical response to reality. We could say the same of the books of Franz Kafka, for instance, which are comments and critiques on certain aspects of society, like the bureaucracy in the castle. But there's, of course, other ways of dealing with reality and imagination. The surrealist writers, like Breton, Aragon, they celebrated imagination and tried to keep that as far apart as possible from reality. And following the surrealists, there was an interesting group, mainly in Latin America. Gabriel Garcia Marquez is one of them, of what they called a marvelous or a magic realism. Aware of surrealist literature, they said, well, but why should we seek for different ways of celebrating the imagination if the magic is already present in the real? And of course, in South American culture, there is much stronger presence of myth. And these books of Gabriel Garcia Marquez or Alejandro Carpentier are full of myths that are based on reality. So there, just to say that there is different ways that literary writers deal with this balance between reality and imagination and somehow take a position in that. And that's, of course, something that architects do as well, consciously or not. The literary theorist Mikhail Bakhtin, Russian theorist, spoke of the notion of a chronotope. So chronos as time and topos as place. So this is the kind of spatial temporal construction that writers use to structure their books. This is something that this could be an underlying principle. So if we think of, for instance, the work of Walter Benjamin, it's a kind of impressionistic chronotope. It's a chronotope of the here and now, of experiencing a particular place at a particular time. But there's, of course, other chronotopes that have a much more historical background. An architect who used a lot these prescriptive techniques and mainly borrowed from surrealism is Rem Koolhaas. He was actually trained as a scriptwriter, and his father was a famous novelist, Anton Koolhaas, in the Netherlands. So before starting to study architecture at the AA in London, he was trained as scriptwriter, and he wrote for a couple of Dutch magazines, and he made a couple of films before moving to architecture. And he was very inspired by surrealist practices, both in art and in literature. And for his book, Delirious New York, he took Dalí's method of the paranoid critical as a point of departure. And he said the paranoid critical, and this is a quote by Koolhaas, was a delirium of interpretation. Each fact, event, force, observation is caught in one system of speculation and understood by the afflicted individual, the one who's paranoid critical, in such a way that it absolutely confirms and reinforces his thesis, that is, the initial delusion that is his point of departure. So, says Koolhaas, this is a rational method which does not pretend to be objective, through which analysis becomes identical to creation. So, if we move to Delirious New York, actually there was a nicer picture, yeah. The old picture of Delirious New York, the old cover. This is a book that was written with that surrealist method in mind. There was this idea of the theory of congestion, the idea of some kind of theory of Manhattanism that might have been underlying the whole birth of Manhattan. And Koolhaas organizes all the facts and all the stories that he finds in his research in Manhattan, also in the 70s, same period as Bernard Tschumi, organizes it in such a way that it proves this idea of that there would be a kind of doctrine of Manhattanism. So he uses that paranoid critical method in the book. But also you can see that there are a lot of surrealist techniques such as metaphor, such as the cadaver exquis and so on. I'm not going to go much into detail in many of their projects of these early 80s, late 70s. This was a proposal for the terminal in Zeebrugge. This was the proposal for the Dutch parliament, which was made in a cadaver exquis kind of way. That is the way that the surrealist used designed different parts separate from each other. And this is the later project, Casa da Musica in Porto, where you see there is a strong kind of, it's a kind of alien figure that has landed in Oporto. But at the same time, there are many many instances of experience of that building. Koha said himself that architecture is very similar to script writing. He says, in a script, you have to put different episodes together. And that's exactly what he's doing here in this Casa da Musica. It's a very strong statement, but within that building, there are very different scenes that are somehow built up together the experience of the project. Okay, I move to landscape. Our OASE issue, recent OASE issue of narrating urban landscape, continued, of course, this idea of narration. How can we use narration? How can we use storytelling as architects, landscape architects, when we deal with these contemporary urban landscapes? I edited together with Bruno Nottebaum, a landscape architect professor in Belgium, and Saskia de Wit, my colleague in Delft. We had a part of the issue is a historical elaboration of works of Kevin Lynch, of Edmund Bacon, and some others, and part is presenting some contemporary practices, and I'll take you through some of these. And here again, we constructed a triple bridge, I realized when making this presentation, which is somehow related to this experience, use, and imagination. It's about using narration to deal with social practices in landscape transformation. It's about using narration in order to include sensory experiences in design. And it's about imagination, or rather using temporality in narrating or stitching together the fragmented and unfinished landscapes of today. Narrating social practices, we had an interview with, this is a contribution by our Belgian colleagues from the University in Leuven, who investigate collective spaces through a narrative approach, and they show some projects in Coney Island and in Belgium. We had an interview with the German landscape architect Anke Schmidt, who uses narrating practices to deal with the different stakeholders in processes of urban transformation, working with what she calls landscape protagonists and involving in different ways users, stakeholders, owners, farmers in the whole process of landscape transformation. And here, this was a student project by a student who made a fictional newspaper to think of the social consequences of a proposal for a new infrastructure in Marseille. So she made this whole fake or fictional newspaper to speculate on the possible consequences of these ideas. There was a contribution by our colleagues from EPFL in Lausanne, Elena Gogato-Lanza and Christophe Giraud from ETH, about the idea of proximity. How do people experience their landscape? What is their social and experiential realm of the landscape? For sensory experience... This was part of the experiential... part. I'm sorry that the slides were skipped. This is part still of Elena Gogato and Christophe Giraud's contribution of this project of proximity. Another way of thinking of the sensory perception of landscapes was this project where two authors used this cinematographic view of looking at the landscape in Leipzig, old former industrial landscape, and using the stills of the film of Stalker, of Tarkovsky, to understand these different parts of the landscape and how this filmish or cinematic narrative could be used to understand and reappreciate these landscapes. And to narrate the fragmented landscape or unfinished landscape, we had an interview with the Belgian landscape architect Bas Smets, about his way of using stories and systems to work with the Belgian landscape. This was an image of his recent exhibition in Antwerp. And we had a contribution by Ed Wall from University of Greenwich in London with his idea of incomplete cartographies, acknowledging that landscapes are always unfinished and fragmented, and how these incomplete cartographies could make sense of this characteristic of the landscape. And finally, this was a contribution of about the terrain vagues, how to make sense of these terrain vagues in Montreal by Carole Levesque, who used walking as a research method, something that also appeared in a lecture of Georges Descombes earlier. I'm thinking of the time, Zas, how much time now, because I have two small projects to show before reading. Okay, I want to show two projects that I presented in this journal issue. We, together with Saskia de Wit, we presented a few of the diploma projects that we tutored in Delft. This was a project of Kristen Van Herren. Her name is skipped here. Kristen Van Herren. She was a Canadian student doing her master in Delft, and coming from the Canadian landscape, she was struck by the Dutch artificiality, that everything seems man-made, is man-made, it's underwater, it's... So for her, this was very, very strange and very unpleasant. She felt that the Canadian landscape is a place where you're rooted and it has a history, while in the Netherlands it was not like that. So her diploma project was about creating place in something that she felt was placeless. And by framing it differently, she for herself discovered that these places did have their own identity. She picked three places, again three. She picked three places in the outskirts of Rotterdam, these kind of urban fringes that are nothing really, somewhere in between city, industry, infrastructure. This is a very typical, the horizontal, by the way, you said the straight line is not a natural. In the Netherlands, the whole landscape is straight line. So the straight lines of the landscape, the ditches and the greenhouses and so on. So she looked at these were the three different sites that she looked at that for her in the beginning had no meaning. She picked them especially for that they were these urban fringes that she said there's no identity, there's no sense of place there. And then what she did was to write a postcard. She said, well, you always send the postcards from a place that's meaningful, a place that you like, and you tell something about the place. So what if I write a postcard about these places? Then something would appear. So then she started to become aware of the specificity of these places, of how there were certain sounds of the infrastructure close by, or of the cattle in the fields, or of the water and the moist and the fog and so on. So by doing these exercises, by being in the place, by making sense of her own perceptions, by writing these postcards, these places started to gain more layers in her perception. And she used partly the methods of Tschumi with this methods from choreography to think about the movements and experiences of the place. And then designed for each of these three places a small object, a pavilion, that would allow the visitor, the walker in that landscape, to have a more intensified experience of that landscape. Sometimes it was about digging into the ground and being immersed in that. Sometimes it was about a bridge or a tower that would allow you to have the open view. So these were some details of the three pavilions that she made. And the second and last project that I want to show, it's also a triple project by David Perottoni, Italian student, who looked at the landscape of northern Italy, Merano, a landscape where also two languages and literary traditions come together, German and Italian. His project was to make a threefold library about these two languages and two literary traditions coming together. First, what he did was try, through reading and writing, to understand this landscape. what are these mountains and these paths and these rivers about? So through writing, but also through reading poems of that were written, there's Hölderlin, there were many, many visitors over the years who came to that area because it was a kind of recreational area with thermal baths and so on. So there were many writers who wrote about that area. So using his own writing and writing that was present about that place, he started to understand the character of the landscape in a very multi-layered way. And from his writings and readings, spatial ideas started to emerge. So his project was really about mixing, writing, sketching, reading. And he designed, in the end, a library in the city with a core where all these books in two languages would come together. Here is the section of the city library, how it's located in the city. And there was a second library at the foothill that was more like an archive. And there was one, and that's this project, refuge, like a small cottage in the in a mountain where that could be a kind of writer-in-residence place. And this was also based on his reading of the landscape, on thinking of the four sides, the fourfold of Heidegger, you could say, of the four sides, and designing from that experience of the landscape. I'll come to the last part of my lecture, and I'll come to tell you why this is precious to me to be in Ljubljana today. When I finished, almost finished, my book that was at that moment still a dissertation about this urban literacy, and I had been using this metaphor of the triple bridge that I encountered here some years before, I thought in order to finish the book I have to go back to Ljubljana. So some years ago, 2011, I went back to Ljubljana for a week or a bit longer, and I edited the final pieces of the work in the library of Plečnik in the University National Library. And I was there every morning until 2, and then I started to trace Plečnik's traces, because I thought if I use this metaphor of the bridge, I need to understand something about this architect and about his other work. So I tried to trace, this is his house, I tried to trace his paths in the city. And I wrote, as epilogue of the book, a story where I imagined myself being the character of Plečnik, using these three perspectives of description, transcription, and prescription. And I'll read it to you. I have to go here. And it's, of course, it's based on reality of what I found here in Plečnik's work. But at the same time, it's, of course, a complete speculation. So here we go. Ljubljana. Oh, sorry. Wrong direction. Yeah. Ljubljana, 1921. No, that's not Ljubljana. Here. Home again, in peace. After more than 30 years in the rush of the metropolis, I have left Vienna and my master Otto Wagner. I have left Prague and the greatness of the city. I was in the center of European architecture. I took part in the development of new ideas for modern architecture, for the cities of the 20th century. I could build in words and stones. Nevertheless, I came back. I am too silent to be in the foreground. I came back to live a modest life, to again inhabit the town in which I'm rooted, that I know so well that it inhabits me. My home is a small house behind the church of Trnovo. Every day I walk the path that I paved with red stones, around the corner, and I enter the church through its heavy front door. It's always pleasantly cold in here, and I like to take place on the long wooden bench with the red pillow seating. My eyes follow the slender curve in the ceiling and meet the light above. I sit in silence. When leaving the church, I find myself in front of the small stream, Gradačica. It comes from the mountain, it winds through the villages, and almost touches my house before meeting the Ljubljanica River just down the road. On Sunday mornings, I follow the Gradačica upstream for a while, then I cross the village of Rošna and take the steep path
with its steps grown from tree trunks to the Rochnik church on the hill. After the service, I descend the other way, through the forest and Tivoli Park, passing the palace, down to the city, where I meet my sister at the river for our Sunday lunch. Walking, I am the reader of my town. I take the same routes over and over, the straight line from home to the city center, or the route following the stream and then the river, a bit longer because of its curves, and also because I stop more often to look at the water below, to smell the wet stones, and to hear the wind playing in the trees. Today, I cross the stream and walk towards the city center. Emona Street, the small houses, trees. Then I cross the bigger Zoy Street that leads down to the Ljubljanica on my right-hand side. In the distance, across the river, I can see the church of St. Jakobski and the castle hill. Continuing my way, I pass old Roman walls, porous stone in shades of gray, yellow, and brown. The small square of the French Revolution, an awkward intersection of minor streets, as if the street hesitates, then bends slightly and continues. Vega Street, lined by trees and more urban buildings, standing a bit higher and a few meters back from the street because of the old remnants. I reach Congress Square. Its size is urban. Its church sits on a corner, which I like. It splits the place in two, as it were. In front of the church, the urban plain, sloping almost unnoticeably down to the river, only blocked by the last row of buildings, the Philharmonic Hall. Next to this, the other half, a park. Maybe I should accentuate this. Make the part in front of the church more monumental, the park more park-like, plane trees rather than chestnuts, the path a star shape, maybe a fountain. In a tavern, I meet my old friend from Vienna, who works at the municipality. We drink a glass of red wine and we smoke, silently. Then I make a sketch and show him the associations I had during my walk, a new layout for Congress Square and some small adjustments along the route. Ljubljana, 1933. That is what I do. I mark the points on my routes. I make connections visible, but I do not unveil the mask entirely. My game is to discover fragments and to bring them to life slowly, one by one. A pavement, a monument for a poet, a lamp pole, a line of trees, a pyramid. My sources are limited, but I use what I can find, what is under my feet. I pulverize stones, I pour concrete, I use what grows, the trees. I use what is left over from demolished houses, columns and windows and piping. I make the scenes separately. And then they begin to communicate. They speak. They speak to people. They tell them how to walk this city, how to use it, where to go and where to sit, where to honor their ancestors, the musicians and poets of this town, where to meet and talk. All of a sudden, one fragment leads to another. I tie them together to form a story, more stories, uncountable stories as all the routes intersect and new combinations can be made. Yes, I believe it is like this. I do not make the story, I make its parts, and provide the means for the people to make their stories out of them. From the intersection of Zoy Street and Emona Street, I have paved the sidewalks. I planted trees to accompany the walk down to the river. From there to Jakobski Square, across the river, it needed verticality, trees, slim poplar trees, to line up with the church. And the river itself, I give it guidance. Where to flow, where to rest, where to be crossed, where to be looked at. I tame it with sluices and cherish it in the city. And then I make it all come together at the three bridges. In fact, I built only two of them, two footbridges on both sides of the old bridge that had become too small. Regarding the old bridge, I simply gave it new railings and lamp poles corresponding to the new bridges on its sides. It was a simple solution, but it fit my purpose. The bridge could in this way become more than a bridge. Through its width and spatial complexity, the triple bridge is an urban place in itself. The paths with different directions make people aware of their position and trajectory, and those of others. The space I left in between the bridges allows the river to be crossed without losing contact with the water. In between, In the niches on the lower banks, I have planted some poplar trees. From both sides of the river, only their leaves can be seen, while from the bridge, the small lawn in which they are rooted becomes visible. Also, I included the lower banks in this interplay. Stairs lead down from the footbridges to a public toilet or to a restaurant. I made the lower bank a place to sit, next to the bridge, under it, part of it, but at a distance. The bridge is simultaneously water and land. It separates and connects, defining the two sides of the river as different entities, while bringing them together. Neither a square nor a building, this place is both a passage and a center. The triple bridge is now the very core of the city, where all the routes intersect. Last piece, Ljubljana, 1940. I am not making a new city. I am fulfilling the city that has in potential always been, and it has waited for me, its architect, to be realized in its full glory. From my modern masters, I learned about monumentality, about tabula rasa and breaking with the past. I had to learn these things in order to forget them consciously, for in Ljubljana, my task is different. I was born in this town and I will die here so that it can become itself. No longer a sleeping provincial town, but the city it has always wanted to be, crowned by its castle, its streets, radiant sunbeams springing off from the center, the river, its vital veem. I am the writer of this city. I write in stones and trees. I write the paths under people's feet. I write the course of the river. I write in repetition. My handwriting repeats itself in the city in different disguises, in the pyramids and spheres at bridges and street corners, silently referring to one another, in the pavement of niches and benches, in subtle additions to buildings, in the replacement of old buildings by new ones, expressing the spirit of true Ljubljana. I have erected a building for wisdom in the city, the National and University Library. Its facade and stone and brick, alive in its plasticity, can be seen from the castle hill, and even when seen from there, its rhythm seems to speak with a million voices of its erudite content. I have given it doors in heavy copper with noble horse heads as handshakes. Inside, the dark tone of respect. Black marble, big columns, a monumental staircase leading in one flight to the reading room, where the light is. I made the reading room high and pleasant. I used wooden paneling for the walls to the floor and the ceiling. I designed wooden tables on marble columns and modern industrial lamps to enlighten the students on their path to knowledge. I have envisioned a plan for a whole new university at the edge of Tivoli Park. How great it would be. Such a center of knowledge and innovation embedded in the city's most prominent park. A dialogue between the old power of the palace and the modern power of knowledge. So far, the municipality has not approved my plan, but I continue to take steps towards it. I have already redesigned the access from Tivoli Palace to the center, widening the path, placing trees and lamp poles along it. I even took care of the dead of the city, so that they, too, will rest in the spirit of Ljubljana. I designed the gates to the Zala Cemetery. I made the chapels, the memorial monuments, the tombstones for the dead. My urban project, my life work, is timeless. There is no distinction between future and past, between the living and the dead. I am neither a modernist nor a classicist. I observe and I craft the city in all its dimensions. I care for its details and its urban whole. I make it speak. I make it come alive by its intersecting narrative. I imagine and I realize this city, my city, Ljubljana. Thank you.